Piers Plowman by William Langland. Read by Jonathan Keeble for Naxos Audiobooks. Vision 1. Prologue. One summertime, when the sun was mild, I dressed myself in sheepskin clothing, the habit of a hermit of unholy life, and wandered abroad in this world, listening out for its strange and wonderful events. But one May morning, on Malvern Hills, out of the unknown, a marvellous thing happened to me. I was tired out after wandering astray, and I turned aside to rest under a spacious bank beside a stream. And as I lay down and leaned back and looked at the water, I grew drowsy and fell asleep. So sweet was the music that it made. Then there came to me an extraordinary dream. It seemed I was in an empty desert place, with no notion of where it might be. But as I gazed eastward, up on high towards the sun, I saw upon a low hill an elegantly built tower. Beneath it was a huge hollow containing a dungeon, with deep dark ditches that struck terror into the beholder. Between them I made out a beautiful field, full of all kinds of people, humble and rich, working and wandering about, as life in this world demands. Some set themselves to the plough, rarely relaxing. They laboured strenuously at planting and sowing, and earned what rapacious men destroy with their greed. Others gave themselves to pride, donning its raiment, and stepped out in a fine fashion of deceit. Many devoted themselves to prayer and penance, and lived ascetic lives for love of our Lord, in the hope of winning beatitude in the kingdom of heaven. These were anchorites and hermits who remain within their cells, and have no itch to go straying about the land to pleasure their flesh with a life of lechery. And some chose trade. They did well, to judge, at any rate, by the way they seemed to prosper. And some chose to be minstrels, and earn their money by music-making, a blameless pursuit, to my mind. But as for obscene jesters, with dirty mouths, those sons of Judas dream up disgusting displays and transform themselves into fools. And yet they have sufficient good sense to hold down a proper job, if they felt like it. I don't intend to spell out here what St. Paul preaches about these people. The fellow who utters filthy words is Satan's slave. Beggars, hungry for handouts, bustled about eagerly until their stomachs and their scrips were stuffed to bursting. They put on quite a front to procure their victuals, and then came to blows over their beer. Dear God, they go to bed with their guts gorged and rise up randy, those thieving gutter snipes. Their constant companions are sleep and sheer idleness. There were pilgrims there who made vows to go on pilgrimage to the shrines of St. James or the saints at Rome. These set out on their journey full of sage speeches, and thereby earned the right to lie about it for the rest of their lives. I saw some who declared they had gone looking for holy ones, but from what they said it seemed that their tongue was tuned to untruth, not the thing it was made for. A gaggle of hermits with crooked staves set out for Walsingham, with their whores behind them. Great strapping layabouts, foes of a fair day's work, dressed up in copes to look different from the rest, and hey presto, they've become hermits, gentlemen of leisure. I found there all four orders of friars, preaching to the people for the benefit of their bellies. They interpreted the gospel as it fitted their book, reading into it whatever meaning they fancied in their greed for smart clothes. Many of these masters can afford to dress as they please, because their costs and their earnings fit like hand in glove. Now, since charities turned trader and heads the queue for hearing noblemen's confessions, many untoward things have happened in the last few years. Unless the friars and the church can improve their relations, a terrible calamity will soon hang over our heads. There was a pardoner preaching there, for all the world as if he were a priest. He produced an indulgence covered with episcopal authorizations, and said that he himself had the power to absolve all and sundry who had failed to observe their fasting penances, or had broken solemn vows. The ignorant put their full trust in him. They liked what he said, and came up to him on their knees to kiss his bull. He gave them a sharp tap with his mandate, and made their eyes water. And with that roll of indented parchment, he netted a haul of rings and brooches.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.